based on discipleship and Christian unity, the conference is being held at the Adamstown Uniting Church. Nearly 100 people have signed up for the all-day seminars and workshops, which cover aspects of growth in the church and its role in modern-day living. One of the guest speakers is Reverend Dr. Bob Hillman from Springwood. Involved heavily in Christian outreach, Reverend Hillman is an expert in the subject of church growth. Leading the open worship sessions in the night is founder of Vision International, Reverend Alan Langstaff. Now based in America, he leads a worldwide evangelistic ministry. Reverend Langstaff will be sharing his experiences and message at the Merriweather Central Church Sunday night.
The fashion parade was the first to be arranged by Bruce Fergus Fashions in 4 years. Called A Splash of Colour for Summer, it featured both women and menswear from Bruce Fergus and Berwick's Man Shop. Six models, including Newcastle's first model of the year, Katie Neal, wore garments by both Australian and European designers. They were made from mainly natural fibres, including Swiss cottons and Italian linens, and were characterised by bold colours and cool, sometimes revealing designs. About 200 people attended the parade, the proceeds of which will be donated to the Save the Children Fund.
That's not to say 20-year-old bodybuilder Paul Polverino doesn't want to make the top. He does. And an important step to winning major titles will be taken on Saturday week when he competes in the 1985 East Coast titles at the Belmont 16 Footers Club. Then it's the Australian titles next month. In his last year as a junior, Paul, who trains at Greg Williams' gym, Jewelstown, agrees that unlike team sports, his pursuit relies totally on individual dedication.
It really is a loner sport, and you put a long time into it.
It is, John, but it all comes out the night of the competition. You find that years of training, the amount of happiness and the gratitude you get from that one night, if you win, it's incredible. It's like playing a full season of football. It's hard for people to understand that, but once you've started bodybuilding and once you've competed, you just want to keep going and go to the top and keep competing.
Do you fall in love with your own body, do you think?
That's a good question. In a way, but it's not really showing off or falling in love with yourself. You've got to... I mean, you're looking in the mirror all the time, but a mirror to a bodybuilder is like a stopwatch to a swimmer. It's the only way of learning progress. And I don't think we fall in love with ourselves, but we certainly have to like ourselves and like the way we look. Because if you don't like the way you look, you're not happy.
The two whales were roughly estimated at around 15 metres long. They were first spotted from the ferry terminal just after midday, taking a leisurely swim into the harbour. With the help of the Whale Rescue Centre in Melbourne, they are identified as humpback whales, the first, it's believed, to ever come into the harbour. Australia was the fourth largest whaling nation in the world, and it wasn't until legislation was passed in 1980 that whales, dolphins and porpoises were fully protected. According to Laurie Levy from the Whale Rescue Centre, it's only been in the last few years that harbours around Australia have reported the return of the gentle giants. Newcastle Harbour Master Neil Morrison says there was no concern over shipping during their visit, as the whales cruised slowly around an incoming ship and its tugs, and then made their way out of the harbour into deeper waters about 2.5 hours later.
The Bayway Centre in the heart of Warners Bay was already doing a solid trade today when the official opening ceremony began. Alderman John Jenkins wasted no time cutting the ribbon stretched across the entry to the three commercial offices in the centre. Bayway is believed to be the first strata retail development in Lake Macquarie, meaning the 10 shops have been bought by the retailers rather than leased. The centre was developed by local businessman Richard Adenall at a cost of $1.2 million. Despite its modest size, the developers believe the centre will boost the fortunes of the Warners Bay Business District. Centre manager Roy White does not see the expansion of Garden City and Jesmond Centre as a threat to Bayway's commercial viability.
I think it will definitely put the ones in jeopardy that do not consolidate, update and expand in respect to offering more variety to the people that wish to shop in the area. People like to shop in their own local area. You know, they will go to a regional centre once a week, once a month for special purchases. But if you're supplying most of those things in a local centre, now I think that the small centres, by developing, can win their customer back and keep their customer.
The exercise was the culmination in a week's training in water manoeuvres for the 5th and 7th Battalions stationed at Holsworthy. It also provided an opportunity for the Royal Volunteer Coastal Patrol to practice searching for vessels attempting to reach the coastline without being detected. The brief for the exercise was short and to the point. Amphibian enemy forces had supposedly been sighted, concentrating in the Soldiers' Point area. Intelligence reports indicated that the Corlett Marina complex was under threat of enemy attack. The Army played its role to the hilt, keeping the Royal Volunteer Coastal Patrol guessing about their strategies.
Well, we imagine all sorts of fairly devious tricks. Because basically, we suspect they may have IR, which is infrared binoculars, which we certainly don't have the benefit of. Mind you, that's only hearsay, so it remains to be seen.
But the Coastal Patrol proved too good and managed to thwart all efforts to reach the marina. Although the Army didn't succeed in winning the exercise, the officer in charge, Major Laurie Douglas, said the skills learnt throughout the week-long course in water skills would prove invaluable.
Being an infantry battalion, this sort of skill is mainly only used when we ever come up against a river or a water gap that we'd need to cross, and we'd use the assault craft to cross, and that would be main times we'd use these skills that they're learning.
it's a really good game to play.
How does it relate to soccer as we know it?
Well, it's virtually the outdoor rules brought indoor. The exception is it's a very fast game. There's rapid substitution, unlike the outdoor game when you're substituted in this game, and the players do that themselves, not the referee. They can come back on the park.
If you're a naughty boy, you're in the bin like ice hockey.
Oh, that's definite. If you play up and it's equivalent of a yellow card in the outdoor game, you get an automatic 2-minute suspension.
You are really an official indoor game though, aren't you? Because you're connected with the Northern Soccer Federation and above that.
We're affiliated with Northern New South Wales Soccer, and that affiliates us with the Australian soccer body.
Right. So you're using the referees that are in the outdoor game?
Yes, official referees only will come here. They'll be the top referees in Newcastle. The aim of that is to look after the players and make sure the players and the referee have a good time.
Ken, the surface is unique and it seems to be excellent to walk on, I guess, to play on.
It's a grade A carpet, Lee. It's one of only three carpets. It's super turf, and it's recommended by FIFA for indoor sports. So we've gone for the best carpet available.
And like everything else in the modern days, even the scoreboard runs automatically.
The scoreboard's brilliant. It's electronic wizard, actually. It's fully automatic. The referee carries a module in his hand, and he controls the clock and he controls the scoring. He has nothing to do with sin bin timing or anything like that. It's done automatic.
For 3 hours, the man threatened to jump from the top of Latek House before police negotiators persuaded him to come down. While police tried to talk to him, a crowd gathered in Hunter Street, but were quickly moved out of sight of the man. After giving himself up to police, he was taken to Mayfield Police Station, where he was interviewed by detectives before being charged with one count of the attempted murder of Mrs. K. Pears at Waratah on the 21st of September, one count of malicious wounding, one of stealing a motor vehicle, and one count of assault on Mrs. Pears' son. Police bail was refused, and the man has been remanded to appear in Newcastle Remand Court tomorrow morning.
Special guest for the evening was Australia's test skipper and world-class Queensland 5'8 Wally Lewis. And he had the good news for the competition's top player.
It's a great pleasure to announce that the NBN 2HDJ's Player of the Year Award goes to Mick Schofield.
Schofield placed second in 1981 before joining Balmain for three seasons. His father, one of the area's greats, Don Schofield, would be a proud man, as Ross Allen pointed out.
It takes a long time to shake off the shadow of a great international father. Michael's done that tonight.
The Goannas also grabbed the National Panasonic Coach of the Year, as Bruce Starkey's outfit won the minor title and set a club games record of 14 on the trot. Central Charlestown's Greg Price took the coveted Carlton Rookie Award.
At nearly every stage of its Salamander Bay project, Port Stephens Shire Council has been accused of acting with too much haste. The sale of the Salamander Commercial Centre, decided at a meeting of council last night, has drawn the same broadside from state leader of the National Party, Wal Murray.
Mr Murray said in State Parliament today that local government minister Kevin Stewart should intervene and stop the sale. He said the sale of the property was not advertised and that council had received an offer in excess of the $1.75 million they settled on.
The successful offer came from Salamander Projects Proprietary Limited, a company which has as a director Ian Henry, the council's property consultant. Shire Clerk John Walsh today confirmed that council did receive a higher offer yesterday of $2.1 million, but said that too many conditions were attached.
Biggest disadvantage is that council was not advised who the end buyer was, and if in fact the end buyer is a person suitable to council. In fact, we could have sold to someone we don't want to sell to.
Now, you received the offer only late yesterday afternoon. Do you think you gave it due consideration? After all, you made your final announcement only hours later.
Yes, I believe it was given due consideration because it doesn't take long to sort out the basics of an offer. And when an offer is such that it's very restrictive on the development of the area, I think council's perfectly entitled to say, well, whilst money is a consideration, it's not the be-all and end-all.
Meanwhile, late this afternoon, Kevin Stewart said he wanted the council to meet with the Department of Local Government. He said the question of the sale would be raised at that urgent meeting and that he'd recommended that council not make any hasty decisions.
Gathered at the Broadmeadow High School yesterday afternoon to say their final goodbyes to friends and family. Flying out from Sydney's Mascot Airport last night, the koalas began the first leg in their 11-day tour of Japan. The band's itinerary for the trip is non-stop. They'll be competing in the New South Wales exhibition at Sunshine City in Tokyo this weekend. Then the band will head off for Osaka, where they'll participate in the Mido Sushi Parade. The crowds will be waiting for them. It's estimated that more than 1 million spectators will flock to the streets, while another 22 million will watch the parade on television. Some band members will then visit Ube, Newcastle's sister city, to join in the festivities marking the 5th anniversary of the relationship. Finally, the band will rejoin in Tokyo for the opening of the Koala Pavilion at Tama Zoo on October the 3rd. And then it's all aboard for the return flight back home. Last night's get-together allowed new owner of the Falcons, Basil Sellers, to meet with the players and their supporters. It was also an opportunity to introduce a new member of the management committee, Brian Smith. Mr. Smith is managing director of National Textiles in Newcastle and will play a major role in the organisation behind the new Falcon team. According to President of the Committee, Cole Stevenson, the club has a three-year plan to win the National Basketball League, and losing star shooter Ian Davies hasn't deterred them. So who's in the Falcons for the 1986 season?
I'll be doing my very best.
It's very difficult to just get a team together. We will have the nucleus of last year's team involved again next year, keeping in mind that three or four players have left the club. And we will be recruiting amongst some Australian players, some naturalised Americans living in Australia, and some overseas players.
Meanwhile, the Australian men's basketball team for the coming Oceania Championships against New Zealand in October has been announced. And as manager Terry Charlton explains, there's a few surprises.
Yes, well, the two omissions, of course, Robert Scrigney and Ian Davies. Ian Davies is a big surprise because he's been one of Australia's best players, and unfortunately he's had a poor second half of the NBL season and hasn't played very well in the training sessions for the Australian team. And the coaches and selectors of the team felt that he wasn't doing enough to stop the young players getting in. And we saw Andrew Gaze and Michael Johnson, Mark Dalton, those young players come into the team.
Michael Johnson is Newcastle's only representative in the team, and it's his first time in the senior Australian side. He represented Newcastle in an Australian under-20 team in 1982 at the World Junior Championship. Michael, you've made it to the team. How do you feel about your selection?
Oh, I'm very pleased, obviously. It's been a big transition from the junior team to the senior team, but you know, it's taken me 2 years to make it. A lot of hard work, but now I'm glad I've made it.